welcome each and every one of you here to the North Charlestown Church of God today. Those that are be watching by web or listening by CD also, like to ask if we have any visitors with us in the building this morning, your first time ever, you're back here with us today. I don't know that I've seen anybody, but again, we just welcome. Really? You've been visiting for a long time, young man. Eric's right in there. But anyway, we just welcome each and every one of you here today. Thank you for being with us today, and also the ones that will be watching. We appreciate that. Again, our schedule of services, I just continue to give that for everybody that's watching and stuff. But again, our Sunday morning service at 10:45, we're having that on the web. I'm thinking things are working a lot better now, so right at 7 or maybe earlier sometime. And then also our Wednesday night Bible study is at 7 p.m. And these are both in the building this morning, of course, and Wednesday night. And then that should be on the web by 7 o'clock Thursday also. And again, we're having our teenagers meet back here in the back. They are having their temperatures checked and doing the social distance, asking to wear the mask. Just like, again, us asked to wear the mask, but also social distance. So, again, those things. Also, the first of the month, on Friday night, we have our movie night. We had, I think, one of the best movies I think I've seen here. It was called The Grace Card. We watched this past Friday night, and it was excellent. If you wasn't able to be here and you've got that ability to find that somewhere on that one of the movie channels or something, pull that up, internet or whatever, that's an excellent movie. I guarantee you it's right on. I think Lisa said it's 10 years old, but it was almost dealing with the things that we're dealing with in the country right now, so racism and then the police officers and all the different things, and it was definitely a movie worth watching. Still having our singing on the last Sunday of the month. We just had that a couple weeks ago, but again, we'll be looking forward to that to the end of this month. Also, tomorrow you guys will be having our men's first meeting at 7 p.m. And again, we're not doing food or nothing. I'll have some waters and coffee to just keep them signified. But also, Barb Garrett asked me to let you ladies know that she's going to have to postpone the women's meeting for a little bit, and she'll be calling you all, and she'll try to reset that up here probably sometime in this month also. So just give you a heads up on that. But the men, we will be having that. If you guys haven't been to it yet, again, we end up having a Bible study, and it's not just me, it's everybody that gets to interact, that wants to. Nobody's made to, but again, we have an enjoyable time with that. And again, that'll be the first Monday of the month, and that'll be at 7 p.m. Like I say, the ladies is canceled, postponed for now, and as soon as we get a time on that, I'll let you know. So again, those are some of the things coming up. And then also, again, the baskets that are set up here around there, those are for our offering of tithe and offering. If you want to put that in when you come in or go out, and I try to remember to pray a prayer of offertory. And I try to remember to say that every week because I've had people wanting to know what we were doing with that. So that's why I'm reminding you of that. So, again, those are just some of the things. And this week, again, we want to remember all the ones that have had loved ones to pass away. Steve Hester had two aunts that passed away, one here in Charlestown, the other one in Hopkinsville. So we want to remember those families, and they both already had their services. And then a lot of you remember, well, Roger McVicker, Elsie McVicker come to church here. Well, Sunday nights in there at the last, she was coming all the time. But Roger, her son, passed away the other day, and they'll be having his service Monday and Tuesday, and that's going to be at Pleasant Ridge. That's a Baptist church, isn't it?
Correct.
And that'll be Monday and Tuesday. So, again, the funeral will be at Tuesday there at the church building, and Grayson's are taking care of that. So, and again, anything you need information on, look on Grayson's website or talk to me after the service. I didn't write it down. And then also, Ronnie had an uncle to pass away, Fred Gregory, and you said he's from where?
He's from Barbourville, Kentucky.
Okay, so he's not around here either, but we want to remember that family also. So these are some of the ones that have passed away. We want to remember their families. Again, Lisa Davis, is it all right to say?
Yeah.
She's going to have a lung removed. It does have two cancerous spots that are contained. They're telling her her other lung is good enough, she shouldn't have no problem, but they felt like it'd be better to take the whole lung. So we certainly want to pray for her. And that may be happening here in the next 2 or 3 weeks then. Mm-hmm. Certainly want to remember her in prayer. Of course, we want to remember our president and his wife. Both of them have got the COVID-19 also. And again, all those that are dealing with that and the people that are quarantined for it and everything else. Continue to remember Vicki Stoner. She's not here with us this morning. Her heart rate was up instead of down, so they're still working on that. And she's going to end up having to have some aneurysms removed whenever she gets that straightened out. So we want to continue to pray for her. Again, there's others we want to remember. My mother that had the fall, and also I had a niece, Katie. She had a fall the other day, and she messed up both of her ankles. So we want to keep her in prayer. And again, Doris Atkins, our Aunt Molly Craig, and then Rick Hartman's going to be having a procedure done here in October at the end of this month. So these are some of the ones that's, again, had things going on. Who's had a birthday this week? Any birthdays in the church? I know of Lisa too. Okay. Lisa Davis, she's had a birthday. Shirley Bay's back here. Is there anybody else had a birthday? Okay. Well, let's sing happy birthday to Miss Birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
And give them a hand this morning. Okay. Have we had any anniversaries this past week? Any anniversaries? You had a birthday and an anniversary. So you got married on your birthday?
That was the best birthday present you ever had.
Well, there you go. That is the, I tell you what, that's the best answer I've ever heard a man ever give to. How many years?
57.
Oh, wow. Congratulations. Amen to that. Amen. So. Again, has anybody, and the reason I mentioned some of the ones I did, has anybody been in, and also Stephen Crane, I think he's been in the hospital this week, again, with his diabetes, and I'm not for sure if he's out. He goes in and out a lot, so I can't keep track, but want to keep him in prayer. But has anybody that you know of from the church been in or this week or in the hospital now that you know of, Martha?
Libby Smith has been in the hospital.
Oh, is she really? Okay.
She may have come home by now.
Okay, thank you for that. Anybody else? Okay. Well, we certainly want to remember them for sure also. And I think that's about all of our announcements right now. I'm going to ask right now, Ronnie, don't mind, our veteran here, he's going to lead us in the pledge, and if you will stand with us. And when we're finished, if you'll just continue to stand, then our music director, Bob, will come up here and lead us in song also.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Morning, everyone.
Morning. Morning.
Everyone glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Yeah.
Let's begin our worship by standing and singing hymn number. We all need to stand now. We'll come get that one these days. Let's turn to hymn number 391.
Hopefully we'll be able to change it, buddy.
Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. 391. Thank you. hymn number 790, When We All Get to Heaven, 790.
Fire!
what we need is that power, isn't it?
Amen.
Praise God. We're going to get ready for our prayer. I know I've done mention a lot of names just to make sure with the hospital and situations. We certainly want to pray for the families that, like I said, that have loved ones that pass away, the Hesters, the McVickers, and also for the Gregory family. We want to keep them in prayer. And again, those that are facing procedures and surgeries, such as Lisa Davis, and again for Vicki Stoner and my mother. I think she's going to have something done down the road on her shoulders later on. Stephen Cranen, still praying for him. The ones that are, again, healing up from procedures, we want to continue to pray for Molly Craig, our aunt, that had shoulders, or she had knee surgery, and then also we want to remember Doris Atkins. She's the one that had the shoulder surgery, so we want to pray for her. And again, mentioning Dennis Eldridge, still having some major health issues with him. Also, Billy, everything going well with you as far as burns and all that? Keep him in prayer. Jim Ross for his foot. Suzanne Murphy that had the fall, we're going to keep praying for. A lot of people's had some fall. We're going to pray for all of them. Joanne Dallas, our niece. Again, Katie Stricker, we're going to keep her in prayer. And then Joanne Dallas, Donna Sumners, these have all had these different situations happen where they've been involved with falls. Also, we want to remember Heaven Williams, praying for that tumor. I think she had a birthday the other day too, didn't she, Pat?
Yesterday.
Okay, well, she happened to be watching. Happy birthday to her also. And then Samantha James, her and Tabitha both had some health issues, and they've asked us to keep them in prayer. Chuck Higdon, Tracy and Gary's son, he is doing somewhat better from that rash. I mentioned Stephen Crane, and remember again for Charles also, he is still dealing with those shingles. I think he's had better days than others. And then his son Chuck, he's had a lot of back problems, and he can't really get anything done right now because of taking care of his son. Talk about Chuck in between Charles, but we want to pray for them also. And then all the ones that are shut-ins, all the ones that are dealing with this COVID-19, including the president and his wife. And then there's a couple unspoken. We want to keep them in prayer. Ones that have had some heart issues and different things, we want to keep praying for them. And then for our country, for our elections, and for everything that's coming up, don't care what side of the fence you're on, as long as we're praying that we're on the right side to the Lord. So that's the main thing we'll pray for. But anyway, taking prayer requests from you all here this morning.
Amen.
Absolutely.
Nice book.
Thank you.
Family, friends that are lost, and this election that's coming up, for God's will to be done.
Yes,
sir. Absolutely. Other prayer requests up here, anybody?
Family. Home and our church.
Thank you much. Amen. Others. Over here on this side, prayer request, Ernie.
Mom, family, and I spoke.
Okay. Ronnie.
Family and friends.
Okay. Absolutely. On through here, Tracy.
For Chuck, and also for Janelle, the one's got cancer. She's 43, and she got it in her liver, her lungs, and her brain. She's only 43. She needs prayer.
Absolutely. Other prayer requests, Jim?
Herschel.
Yes. I did get to finally talk to him the other day.
He said you did. I talked to him last night, and he asked me to pray for him.
Absolutely.
He got off sick yesterday. Mm.
Absolutely. Sheila?
My sister Kathy.
Okay. Other prayer requests? Rick?
Family.
Okay. Tammy, it's good to see you here. That's why I know you've been working a lot of work. Good to see you. Other prayer requests? Sherry?
For Michael's mom, still on her back.
Okay. Eddie?
Pray for myself and my family.
Absolutely. Anybody else prayer requests? Miss Sandra?
For family and for those that are...
Yes, for all the expecting mothers, yes. Still got two or three of them, actually. So, other prayer requests on this side, Lisa?
For Serena, she's still having those pancreas problems, and she goes to the doctor tomorrow. Hopefully, they'll get something done.
Okay. Is that what you're praying? Okay. Other prayer requests, Lillian?
For me, I just can't hardly breathe.
Mike, do you have your hand up?
For myself, my mom, family, friends, and I got some families in traffic in Florida.
Absolutely. Billy?
Just here for Buddy's dad, Wayne, playing out my work. He just got off the hospital. He mugged in that virus. He's not doing very sick. He thought, good, good. He
Remember Judy Hall also. I haven't seen her for a little while. I need to be praying for her. Vanessa?
Her family, and I haven't spoken.
Okay. Anybody else on this side? Prayer request? How many with uplifted hands for yourself or someone else? Again, God sees those hands. As we stand this morning, if you will, let's agree in prayer here today. And again, our prayer book remembers anytime you got names you want to put on there, we certainly keep them in prayer. And help me to remember when we finish praying that we end up doing our Bible thing before we have the song, so I don't have you bouncing up again. But anyway, let's agree in prayer here this morning. Father God, we thank you, Lord, once again this day. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us to gather together with brothers and sisters in Christ. And Lord, you said where two or three are gathered together in your name, that you're in our midst, Lord. And God, every one of us need you with us. And we know as children of God, your Spirit dwells with us. But Lord, we need that encouragement and strength from one another. And I pray that just penetrates through every one of us, Lord. I know we still struggling with the social distance and all those different situations. But Lord, just being together with people that you love and care about, what a blessing that is, Lord. And again, we do want to lift up the families that have had loved ones that passed away, Lord. We pray for each and every one of their members of their families, Lord, that God, you'd help encourage them and friends and loved ones. We just pray that, again, you'd help them through the grieving time, help them to sense your presence and power, and especially those that have not been laid to rest yet that will be having services. We continue to pray for them. Again, Lord, for those that are facing surgery, Lord, here in the very near future, we want to pray for them, especially Lisa here with that lung removal. We want to pray for her, Father God. Again, for Vicki Stoner this morning, Lord, with that heart rate, pray that they can get that back in order for her, the medication, whatever she's doing, AFib and the different things that are taking place, Lord. We lift her up in prayer. And again, for Bobby Doss, he's been going through some situations. We want to pray for him. And again, for Ronnie and Brenda and others that have either dealt with the COVID or are dealing with it, even the president and his wife, and again, a host of others, Lord, we just pray for each and every one of them, Father God, that you'll touch them. And again, Lord, we do want to pray for Herschel this morning. And again, it was good to hear him saying he was doing better, but now still having some frustration there with the body. I just pray that you'll touch and minister healing and health to him. Again, for all those that are quarantined, I know we pray for ones that are dealing with it, but the ones that are quarantined, whether they have it or not, waiting to find out, we pray for your hands upon them. Again, for our Aunt Molly Craig and Doris Adkins, those that are healing, pray for Rick Hartman and his procedure coming up. Continue to pray for Ann Wheeler. We pray for Billy back here, for Billy Glass. Continue healing and health for Jim with his foot. Again, for all the ones that have had falls, for Suzanne, Joanne, and Donna, we continue to pray for them. Heaven Williams, for that tumor to be completely gone in Jesus' name. For Samantha James, we want to continue to pray for her and Tabitha both, Lord. They're dealing with that, again, whatever's causing the breathing problems, and Tabitha having so many problems getting around. We just pray your touch upon them. Chuck Higdon with that rash to completely be gone. And again, for the Cranon family, we pray for all of them, Lord, for the grandpa, the dad, and the son, Lord, that's been having healing and health, or needing healing for some health issues for all of them. And then for our friend Paul and Elizabeth that's been dealing with that COVID also, we lift him up to you in prayer. Again, Lord, for all the things that have been mentioned here today, Lord, for our prayer book of remembrance, for the hands that went up here this morning, Lord God, each and every need that's been brought forth, Lord, you know what they are. You know the hurts and the pains that people are going through. You know for our country, Lord, we need, God, your touch upon it. We do pray for these elections. We pray for, again, for the spirit of argument and hatred and strife to be set aside. And we pray, God, for your will to be done, as was mentioned there earlier. And, God, for the hands of the Lord to be up on that situation, Lord. Help us to vote, Lord, our heart, our conscience. But help us, Lord, to love one another while we do so, regardless of our feelings and situations with that also. And again, Lord, we pray for all those that are in authority. We pray again for our militaries, police departments, fire departments, medical departments, our EMSs, our farmers, for all those that protect and serve and watch over us. We pray that you'll protect us, Lord. And we do pray for those that have been deployed and for those that are still in the country doing the service and those that are in other lands. We pray for them also. And again, Father God, bless and anoint this service here today. Fill us afresh with your Holy Spirit. Help us to sense your power. And Lord, let your glory flow in this place. I pray for those that are discouraged today, those that are downtrodden today. I pray that when we leave here today that we can say truly it's been good to be in the house of the Lord and we'll continue to sense your presence. We thank you for this time of prayer and touch us all, we pray. In Jesus' name and all God's children said,
Amen.
And if you will, if you got your Bible with you, if you'd like to, let's hold them up to the Lord this morning. And I'm trying to do better without not making you bounce up and down. I apologize. But anyway, agree with us today and say this with me if you will. This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
This is the Word of God.
This is the Word of God.
It is a lamp to my feet.
It is a lamp to my feet.
It is a light to my path.
Light to my path.
Its words.
Its words.
Will I hide in my heart.
Will I hide in my heart.
That I might not.
That I might not.
Sin against God.
Sin against God.
All Scripture.
All Scripture.
Is inspired of God.
Inspired of God.
Blessed are the doers.
Blessed are the doers.
And not the hearers only.
And not the hearers only.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. There you are. Dave. Wire is going to come and do the special. Give him a hand this morning, please.
You'll see what I'm doing. Yeah, I know I'm loud. As my wife said, I'm a nervous wreck this morning. Not because I'm nervous about singing. I'm nervous about talking about my Christ. But it's more like a, do I cut the red wire or do I cut the blue wire? And if I cut the wrong wire, it'll blow up and kill us all. I just hope you understand what I'm trying to get at this morning. When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the world is tossing me like a ship out on the Thou who rulest wind and water, stand by me. And there arose a great storm. And the note came that due to COVID, the business would be closing, and all the employees would lose their jobs. There arose a great storm, and the phone rang. And that loved one had been in an accident. And there arose a great storm, and the doctor said, we found a lump. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And they said to him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose, and he rebuked the wind. And he said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that ye have no faith? Life is easy when you're up on the mountain,
and things change. You're down in the valley. Please don't lose faith, for you are never alone. The God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. For the God of the good times, He's still God in the bad times. You talk of faith when you're up on that mountain, but talk comes so easy when life's at its best. But it's down in the valley of trials and temptation. When faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain, He's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, well, He'll make them right. For the God of best, but it's down in the valley of trials and temptations. Oh, that's when faith is really put to the test. When the God on the mountain,
maybe you're going through something in your life and you need a time of prayer. I feel like there might be somebody here today that might just need to just take time to step out. Whether you're a believer or whether you're wanting to be a believer, maybe the Lord is dealing with your heart today. Now, I was taught by Brother Cash to try the Spirit. And if 100 people come in here, we don't have 100 people in here this morning, but if they did, that'd be fine. But if one person needs to be touched by the Lord today, I certainly don't want to hold back on that. So as He plays this one more time, if you will you stand with us one more time? And again, I'll not wear you out with that, but if there's somebody here today that needs to come to this altar, maybe that song's speaking to your heart. I just can't. If it's an equal thing for somebody today, it's an equal thing for all of us. But if He would.
is easy. When you're up on the mountain, it's so easy. When life's at its best, but then things change. When things go wrong.
all know that I don't do that often. I just want to make sure it's the Lord.
Amen.
I don't want to miss out on something God's wanting to do.
Amen.
And when He's wanting to move on His people, we need all the moves we can get from God. Don't we? I want to ask you this morning, if you will, turn your Bible to a very familiar scripture, John 3:16. I still remember Vernon Knapp, who used to sing the song, "Love Lifted Me." And he would replace that with John 3:16 when we would come to that part. Instead of saying, "Love lifted me," he would say, "John 3:16 lifted me." Knowing that we as Christians understand what John 3:16 really means to us.
Yeah.
And I do want to read through that verse, and all the way down to verse 21 here this morning. And again, the favorite verse of many. For God, the creator of the universe, the giver of life, the sustainer of eternity,
amen,
the one that cares for you and I, the one that made the light to shine out of darkness, for God, not just a God, but the God, our God,
yes,
for God so loved
the world.
Who's in the world?
Us.
Every one of us. God so loved you today. You can put your name in there if you want to. God so loved you, Ronnie. God so loved you, Ernie. God
Amen.
So loved you, Serena, Doug, Willie, Ernie, Billy, all of us. Again, I could mention everybody's name in here if I could remember you. And I'm pretty sure most of you in here I do. But again, you can put that name in there today. For God so loved the world that He gave. He didn't take, He gave. Matter of fact, Jesus said, "No man takes my life, I lay it down."
That's right.
Woo, isn't that a great thing?
Amen.
Your goodness. He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever, and again, you're one of those whosoever's today, if you're here alive today, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish. Perish from being in the presence of God. One of these days, this life's going to come to an end.
It will.
And we're either going to spend an eternity with God or we're going to spend an eternity separated from God. And that's where that perish comes in. And you know, 2 Peter 3 said, God's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But going back to this famous verse, should not perish but have everlasting life. Boy, the God on the mountain is still God in the valley, isn't He?
He is.
Wow.
All the time.
The thief comes not but for to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus said, I've come to give you life and to give it to you more abundantly.
That's right, amen.
That abundantly doesn't mean I got millions of dollars rolling out of my pocket. That abundant life means I've got eternal life.
Right.
That abundant life don't mean that I'm driving the nicest and living in the greatest and there's nothing wrong with that, but that's not what that abundant life is. We've got abundance in this world many times, but I'm talking about abundant life that He gives us. I'm talking about security. And I'm not talking about some kind of alarm system we put on our houses or our buildings. I'm talking about a security that says, if I'm in Christ, then I know when I go, I know where I'm going.
Amen.
And I know that I'm going to be with my Lord and Savior, and I'm going to be with those that have gone on before me,
that
have had faith in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
I believe you could just preach forever on that one verse, couldn't you? Because it says so much. I'm not going to do that, but I'm just saying there's just so much packed up in that verse. Because it says it all. But have everlasting life. But I do want to go to the next verse where it says, for God sent not His Son into the world to condemn. How many people have ever talked about God like God's just, you know, pointing a finger, trying to, I'm just wanting to get them. I just can't wait to get them. Some people got that feeling that God's just waiting to get them. I'm going to tell you, Satan's already got them anyway. God's not wanting to get them to destroy them. God's wanting to get them to lift them up. I'm not saying that judgment don't come. I'm not saying the wrath of God's not poured out. But I've got to tell you, we're in a time period right now called grace. God's marvelous grace.
Amen.
Grace that can save and set a sinner free. I'm talking about His grace. I didn't earn it. I didn't deserve it. I didn't do enough good works or do this, that, or the other. God just give it. And if I'll accept it, God can turn my life around. God can turn your life around. And I know for the biggest part, more than likely, we're Christians in this building here today. Excuse me. More than likely, many that are watching on the web or listening to my CD. But if by chance you would not know where you stood at with Christ, again, He's not out to destroy you. He's out to fix you.
Yes, He is.
He's out to lift you up and make you something new. God's not a mean, bad God. I'm not saying God doesn't judge. I'm not saying God doesn't pour out wrath. But I'm saying right now, on this side of eternity, Jesus didn't come. You know, I know God sent the water in the flood to destroy the earth. But when He sent Jesus, He didn't send Jesus to destroy the earth.
No.
Look at the rest of that. You're reading the same Bible I am. If you got a different one, get rid of it.
Right,
if it don't say the same thing mine does. It says, and again, I'm not down on your translation, but I'm saying if it don't come out with the same portion here. It says, "For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world
through Him
might what?
Be saved.
Oh, glory to God.
Yes.
Saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. It's a free gift from God. Aren't you glad that God again so loved you? And again, if you're a child of God, you can rejoice in that.
Amen.
If you know that your name's written down in the Lamb's Book of Life because Jesus has been sent to save us. Now, Jesus come the first time to save us. The second time He's going to come forth, not as a Lamb of God, but as a Lion of the tribe of Judah.
Amen.
And then He's going to sit down and rule in authority, right, which again, His Spirit is already doing that in the hearts of believers now, I hope. Mm-hmm. It will allow Him to. But it says, but that the world through Him, and again, I know that word might has some meaning to it because I would that everybody was saved, but can I tell you that everybody's not?
No.
It would be nice, and like I said, many times they've talked about 50% of America's Christians, and again, they may be Christians by name, but that means every other person you meet is a born-again believer, and I think we all know
better than that.
That's not exactly the way things are, is it? And I'm not doubting the way that I'd like to see that. But just turning your idiot box on, because it's idiotic all the things that are going on when they show that television program, isn't it? The newscasts.
Yeah.
The shooting, the killing, the looting, the rioting. You can have your peaceful protest, but again, make sure that we're not having all that other stuff. Dear goodness. You don't have to set a building on fire to prove something. You don't have to knock a glass out. You don't have to shoot somebody because they wear a blue uniform. You don't have to do. But again, without a change from Christ, we all have a lot of problems in our life, don't we? That's why salvation is so important, isn't it? Only salvation. We can preach here and make people mad as heck, can't we? Make them just tumble and want to throw something at the TV or the computer they're watching or shut the thing off or whatever or leave the building and get upset because the preacher said something they didn't like or this, that, and the other. But when it boils down to it, the only way you're going to like what God's Word says is to have God in your heart.
Amen.
To have Jesus Christ setting up something in your life. And maybe you're in the valley of decision. You don't know where you stand at with God. Today would be a wonderful day to make the right decision.
Yeah, it would.
Maybe you've never had that conversion in your life. I've never accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord. Or maybe you're one of those persons that at one time walked a perfect path with Christ. Not because of me, but because of trust in Him. But I've got off track a little bit. I started getting off the wayward a little bit. I started what Brother Cash used to say, straddling the fence. And guess what? You can't straddle the fence. The Bible says over Matthew 6:24, I believe it is, no man, anthropos, which means male or female, no person can serve two masters, for he either love one and hate the other, or he'll serve one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon, or the things of this world, because the things of this world are controlled by the little god, which is Satan, that controls, unfortunately, the world today. Wow. Verse 18 says, he that believeth on him is not condemned. Yeah. I'm not going to be judged for heaven or hell because I believed in the Son of God.
That's right.
I will be judged for works. Lost people will be judged for punishment. But at the same time, as far as what Jesus did for us for salvation, I don't have to, that's paid for if I continue to trust in Jesus.
Amen.
He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. You don't have to go around beating people over the head and tell them, you know, that they're lost or saved. You need to share the light of Jesus Christ that the Holy Spirit will touch and move upon their life. I'm not telling you to lie to people. I'm not telling you not to discipline your children. I'm not telling people not to take authority that's in authority position. But I'm telling you, God's the one that changes a life. And it says, he that believeth on him is not condemned. He that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is condemnation, that light is come into the world, and man loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were what?
Evil.
Any of you ever been, and I know I've given this example before, the Mammoth Cave?
Yeah.
Down there in Cave City? And you know the tour that they go through, and they take you down there to that, you know, where they call it the bottomless pit thing, and they have a name for that room. But they get you in there, and then about the time you're standing around there, they shut all the lights out. Have you ever seen so much darkness at one time? I mean, it's almost scary to think how dark it is. And then one of the ones that are showing you, they'll either light a match or, and I don't even think they do that anymore, they'll turn on their light. And that light is like a savior. I'm not saying it is, but I'm saying all of a sudden the darkness goes away. And all it is a little light, but it takes away the darkness. All of a sudden, my ability to get around is straightened out because I can see where the sides of the walls are. I can see where craters are at. I can see where I might trip. I can see where I might fall down. And all of a sudden that light gives me some directions. How many of you know that's the way Jesus does in our life? He's like that darkness that's all over the world right now. And then all of a sudden it don't take much light to just show you what you need to see. But I've got to be willing to want to see it, don't I? I mean, you can almost taste that light when you're down there. I can remember because it's just kind of it's a scary thing. And I'm not saying I'm walking around like a coward, but I'm just saying when you're in total darkness and all of a sudden, you all that have had lights go out, I know you're all chasing candles down. I know you're all looking for light bulbs. I know I'm talking about electric lights that run off battery. I know you're looking for those things. You're not walking around saying, oh, I'm just glad the electricity's off and I can't see nothing. You can't wait to find something to light up. Anybody know what I'm talking about when your lights go off at home? I know another subject there, but when the electricity goes out and it's the middle of the night, dear goodness, the first thing you're doing is looking for candles. And it's already bedtime. It's time to go to sleep anyway. But you got to have that light on. What does that light do for you? It gives you security, doesn't it? It makes you feel safe, doesn't it? Because I can see what's around me. I don't like darkness because darkness can have evil in it. And that's the way people without a converted heart are. Without a change in their life, they're still walking in the darkness. And that's what Jesus is saying here. And it says in verse 19 again, and this is the condemnation, that light is coming to the world. And men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. They don't want a spotlight on them. Satan don't want a spotlight on him either, does he?
No, he don't.
He wants you to just think evil's okay, don't he? Isn't that what happened to Israel? They begin to call good evil and evil good. Does that sound maybe familiar? Isn't that where our world's at right now? They're calling evil good and good evil?
Yes.
I mean, if you're doing something right in the name of Jesus Christ, you're a heathen to hell. You just can't be good. I mean, you're actually, you don't do the things we do, you don't behave the way we do, and you actually love people that hate you. You actually care about people that would spit in your face. You say, that's pretty hard to do. Yes, it is. You won't do it without Jesus, I assure you. It won't happen without Christ, will it? Verse 20 says, for everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved or exposed. When people are walking in evil, they like to walk in the darkness, don't they? A thief don't come during the daytime and turn on the headlights, does he? A thief don't come in the middle of the night and turn on your lights and ring your doorbell, does he? I mean, a thief sneaks in when nobody's looking, don't he? You say, well, they're cowards. Well, yeah, they are. So is Satan, though, isn't he?
Yes.
Do you think he's going to mess around with light?
No.
Because light's what comes from Jesus Christ. You remember in the Bible in Genesis when it says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth was without form and void, and darkness, and darkness, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And God said, His Spirit moved upon the face of water, and He said, let there be
light.
When did He create the sun and the moon? Not the first day, but the fourth.
Mm-hmm.
What was that light that He was talking about? God was revealing Himself in creation. Light is a revelation of God. Light is an exposing of truth. Light is an exposition of what you need to know that's right. Matter of fact, Adam and Eve had that pretty good until they took hold of the wrong tree, didn't they? Aren't you glad that Jesus is the light of the world? Aren't you glad that you are the light of the world, by the way? You know, Jesus said you're not some kind of light that you put under a bushel basket. Remember I was talking about when the lights go out, you don't put a candle underneath your bed so you can't see it. You put it out where you can look at it, don't you? And not only look at the light, where you can see what's around you. So you don't trip and fall. So you don't hurt yourself. Some of you that have had falls, I know some of you here today, and again, you've had some hurts and pains, and it may have not been in the dead of darkness, but something you didn't see caused you to fall, didn't it? I'm going to tell you, this is something that's trying to cause every one of us to fall every day, isn't there? And it's not Christ. He's not trying. God didn't give His Son that we could just go to hell. God gave His Son so we could go to heaven. God didn't give His Son just so He could judge us and condemn us to a lake of fire. God gave His Son so we could have eternal life.
Yeah.
So we could have a relationship with Him. So as Dave was singing that song today, the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. Because I dare say every one of us has probably went through some valleys this week, haven't we? I mean, every time that clock ticks, there's another opportunity of a valley, isn't there? I know there's opportunities for mountains, but there's also opportunities for valleys, isn't there? Wow. Aren't you glad that God so loved us?
Amen.
I better read on because you all want to leave before 3 o'clock, right? 2:30. Appreciate that. I know better. That's all right. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth. You know, Jesus don't want us to just be hearers of the word, does he? He wants us to be doers of the word. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought, or they work, that they are worked in God. We've got just a few minutes. I want to ask you, if you will, move over to John chapter 8. We won't go very far. John chapter 8. When you got it, say amen, hallelujah, praise the Lord, or something.
Hallelujah, praise the Lord.
John chapter 8, verse 1. It says, Jesus went into the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again unto the temple. And all the people came unto him, and he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and the Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken, O-G-O, in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they say unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. I wonder how they know that. And again, as we've mentioned in others, there's somebody missing here, isn't there?
Yes, there is.
In an adulterous affair, it takes two to tangle, don't it?
Yeah.
But I only see a woman brought there, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now Moses in the law, by the way, this isn't scripture, but at the same time, now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be what? Stoned. Now, if you're stoned, that's judgment to kill you, right?
Yeah.
That such should be stoned, but what sayest thou? We better learn John 3:17 while we're learning John 3:16 too, hadn't we? For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that through His Son the world might be
saved.
Folks, that's not a license to sin, but I got to tell you, people that are lost don't need a license to sin. They do it regardless, don't they?
Mm-hmm.
When I was lost and undone without God or His Son, I did a pretty good job at sinning. How about some of you today? You don't have to say amen or hallelujah to that, but you already know the answer to that question. But when I got saved, when I got born again, I don't want to do those things. I don't want to be like that. I'm not saying you, I'm not saying any of us are Mr. or Mrs. Perfect, but at the same time, we have a different desire, don't we?
Yeah.
We have a different delight in life. But again, they're dealing with this woman that's not even born again yet. How do I know that? Because Jesus hasn't went to the cross yet, has He?
Right.
He's preparing them for what He's about to do, isn't He?
Mm-hmm.
He said, but what sayest thou? And look at verse 6. You think they cared about that woman caught in adultery? You think they cared about the laws of Moses? You think they cared about having justice? No, no, no. It says, this they said, tempting Him. They wanted to destroy Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted to destroy the Savior of the world. They wanted to be in authority. They wanted to be in leadership. They didn't want nobody telling them what to do. And they didn't want somebody else leading other people that they wanted to lead. They wanted to be the leaders. That's what the scribes and the Pharisees always did. They wanted to be. And I'm not downing religion as long as it's got the right motive. The Bible says true and pure and undefiled religion before God is to visit the fatherless and the widows and to keep yourself unspotted from the world. That means orphans and widows. But at the same time, and in their afflictions or sickness, but to keep yourself unspotted from the world. Religion is usually just nothing more than a formality, going through the motions. We do that when we put our right foot into our right shoe, as I've said, in the left shoe, left foot in the left shoe. But anyway, wow. It says, this said they, tempting Him that they might have to accuse Him. But Jesus stooped down and with His finger wrote on the ground as though He heard them not. And everybody always wants to know what He wrote.
Yeah.
And I don't have a clue no more than you do. Mm-hmm. And you can speculate all you want to and it don't make no difference. I got a feeling He might have just said, I love you. He might have written that in red if I remember a song right.
He did.
If He didn't say it here, He said it somewhere else, didn't He? How was that when He was on the Father, what was the other word?
Forgive
them, for they know not what they do. Wow. Goes back to God so loved us, didn't it? That He gave. Well, He never did stop giving, did He? He's even given us the earnest of His Spirit to be with us today, hasn't He?
Amen.
Isn't that awesome? And it says, going on here, so when they continued asking Him, He lifted up Himself and said to them, He that is
without
sin
mm-hmm.
among you, Let him first cast a stone at her. I know we probably use that more than we need to sometimes, because we use that every time somebody points a finger at us, but sometimes we need to point a finger at ourselves, don't we? Because that's not the only part of the scripture I want to enlighten for the next few minutes. But it says, he that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. Remember, the Bible talks about a man trying to remove a speck out of somebody else's eye when he's got one in his? Got a beam in his own eye? He didn't say you could never help that person get the speck out of their eye, but he said before you try to get that little speck out of that person's eye, make sure you get that big old log out of yours, because you're having a whole lot of trouble seeing through it. Because you're thinking that because they're doing something bad, you've got a right to do something even worse. And there's a word that we won't use today, but that's pretty foolish, isn't it? He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. Isn't all of us guilty of sin somewhere in our life?
Oh, amen.
Yeah. And if we die without a Savior, the wages of sin is what? Death, isn't it? But again, the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Aren't you glad of that?
Oh, amen.
Have you ever... Can I have maybe 10 more minutes? Right. 5 or 10, please. I promise I'll make up for it next week. I appreciate this guy. He's getting better all the time. When I first moved where I live at over in Sellersburg right now, have you ever got something that was too big to tackle with? It was over your head and you was trying to do it yourself?
Oh, yeah.
We had and I think somebody had already chopped it down or I did something. There was a tree in our front yard and somebody had cut it down or I did. I don't remember, but there was a stump in the front yard. And that stump was rough on lawnmowers. And that stump was something easily tripped over too if you walked through there at nighttime, once again. And I decided I was going to get rid of that stump. And I dug, and I dug, and I dug, and I took an axe, and I axed, and I axed, and I axed. Over, you know where I'm going. And I worked on that thing content. I worked on it probably saying it wasn't a couple days. I was trying to get that stump out in the front yard. And I mean, I looked like an idiot. I mean, I was doing everything. I even tied the truck to it, tried to pull it out. Like to rip the bumper off the truck, trying to pull it. I got a little old S10 trying to pull a stump out of the ground. And I mean, wow. When I jerked on it, it looked like the bumper was going to jerk, not that stump. And I did tear a few corners off of it, probably the truck too, but I never could get the stump out. And I kept trying out. Everybody tells you to pour this on and set this on fire. I tried everything. But I finally realized that that stump was too big for me. And while I was out there working and sweating and going crazy one day, I looked down the street and there was a guy by the name of Patrick's Tree Service. And in the back of that big truck, he had one of them things called a
stump
grinder. And I went down there and asked, and I didn't have a lot of money at the time, and I went down there and I asked the guy, I said, could I get you to maybe come down here and look at this stump? I said, I worked on it, and he seen I was wore out, and he said, man, you've been working on it hard, haven't you? I said, yes. I said, could you look at that for me and see what you might charge to take it out? And he said, as soon as I finish up here, I'll go right down there. Well, I had to go to the groceries or something. I took off and left for a while. And when I come back, guess what? That stump was gone. I went to the grocery store. I went somewhere and I wasn't gone very long. And the thing that I had worked on for 2 days solid, that guy took out while I was gone for just a few minutes. How many times have we tried to do something such as getting sin out of our life? Such as straightening our own act up, such as turning over, what is that, at New Year's, a new leaf? And tried to do that. And then find out I just fail every time. I just keep failing over and over again, and I can't do it. It's too big for me. That's the way this life is without Christ. It's too big to fight. Because Satan will beat the literal heck out of you. And he don't stop and he don't go on vacation, does he?
No. No, he doesn't.
You know what? When I come back, I asked the wife, I said, did you pay or what? What did you? She said he left his card and said, send him the money when you get it. Boy, that was grace, wasn't it?
Mercy, yes.
I made sure I did pay him, by the way, too. But I mean, I could have cheated. Somebody trusted me enough. Somebody cared enough to give me a grace shot. How about that?
Amen.
And I know a stump isn't that big a deal, but there's a lot bigger problems in our life than stumps, isn't there? There's a lot bigger hurts in our lives than the trials that we sometimes face with little things like that. But I better read on it again, just a few more minutes. And it said, and again he stooped down and wrote on the ground, and they which heard it being convicted by their own conscience. Have you got a conscience today?
Yes.
How's it working? You know, if you keep shutting your conscience, you know what eventually will happen? It'll shut down, won't it? It'll quit messing with you, won't it? That's what a lot of people have did. They've heard their conscience over and over again. You need to get right with God. You need to turn over your life to Christ. You need to do what's right in the sight of God. You need to read your Bible. And your conscience just keep dealing with it. And you keep saying, I will, later. And it just, the voice keeps getting smaller and smaller, doesn't it?
Yes.
You know, if I read right, the Bible says your conscience can be seared with a hot iron, can't it? It can be shut down. And again, he stooped down on and wrote on the ground, and they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, because they sinned the most, of course, unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, woman, where are those thine accusers? Have no man condemned thee? She said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, listen to these words, neither do I condemn thee. But remember the rest of that verse?
Yes, sir.
Go and sin no more. I've forgiven you. I have saved you. But don't go out there and keep following in the same steps. It's going to send you right to hell. Don't go back into the same things. It's going to destroy your life. Go and sin no more. Wow. Aren't you glad?
Amen.
That God so loved you. Aren't you glad?
Amen.
That Jesus cares for us?
Yes.
I'm going to ask you to stand today. You know, I've been sharing from some scriptures the past 2 weeks on one message, and I guess we should have just made it a series, because I've still got some more scripture, but I know that you all are saying preach on, but I also know that there's some other things going on. And you know what? God's already got our attention anyway, doesn't he?
Yes, sir.
That's really all that matters. It don't matter if a preacher gets to preach for 2 hours. I'm not that stuck on that. I ask for 10 extra minutes. I don't normally even do that, but at the same time, I'm just saying, God's already either speaking to our hearts or has speaking to our hearts. And if there's something that you need to do today and already done, that's wonderful. If there's something you need to do now, that's awesome too. And if you're watching my web today and you don't know where you stand at with Christ, all you got to do is simply ask Jesus. Just simply pray the prayer and say, Lord, I ask you to come into my heart, save me from my sins, set me free, make me the person you want me to be by salvation. And I confess with my mouth Jesus Christ, and I believe in my heart that God has raised him from the dead. And because I believe, I'm saved and I'm a child of God. And if you can believe that and you can trust that, tell somebody. Go and tell somebody what the Lord has done for you. I dare say that lady that was forgiven that day had a story to tell to a few persons, don't you? Maybe she didn't brag about it on CNN News or nothing else like that, but I guarantee you that she told somebody that somebody loved me enough to give me a second chance. Do you need a second chance today? maybe you need a third or fourth chance. I don't know where your chances are. Not much on chances anyway. I'm up on faith. How about you? God's given us that opportunity. If you have a need today, whatever song they're wanting to sing right now, if you need to come to the altars, I know we've done do that, but if there's somebody still, we'll give you just a moment, gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen.
If I walk in the pathway of duty, if I work till the close of the day, I shall see the great King in His beauty. When I've gone the last mile of the way, when I've gone the last mile of the way, I will rest at the close of the day, and I know there are joys that await me when I come.
Glad you went to church today. We're going to close out in prayer. Again, those that are listening and watching, close out for them also. Praying over the offering you've given or going to give, that's fine. But right now, let us agree in prayer. Father God, we come to you this day. We thank you for the time that we've had gathered here today. We thank you for those that have blessed this place with their presence and for those that have watched and listen by CDs and by the web. We thank you for every person. Every value of every soul is worth more than all this world and everything in it. I pray today, Lord, that we can be set free, Lord. Who the Son sets free is free indeed, Lord. And God, may that message that God, I hope that you shared with people through us today, Lord, ring in our hearts, Lord. May we know that, God, you're there for us and that you'll never leave nor forsake us. We pray, God, for the ones that are watching by web and those listening by CD, for their needs, and again, for all the needs that have been mentioned here through this day. And again, Lord, we pray your blessings upon the tithe and offering, and for those that give as well as those that have not. Bless and use for your kingdom, we pray. In Jesus' name, and all God's children said, amen. God bless you again. Turn around and please tell somebody you love them today. You may remember tomorrow night at 7 p.m. if you'd like to come be with us. Again, we'll have some waters and coffee, drinks, whatever. And again, we're not doing food, but come out and enjoy the Word of God together. You're part of it as well as I. And again, remember Wednesday night, our church service. Have a good day, and God bless.
The dirty shame was killing me. It would take a miracle to wash me clean. Then I read the red letters and the ground began to shake. The prison walls started falling and I became a free man that day. Like lightning hit my veins.